Welcome everyone to Force Friday. Hope everyone's enjoying the month of December, right? We're going into the holiday season. Happy Hanukkah for those of you that celebrate Hanukkah. I know that just started. I think you guys have 8 days, if I'm not mistaken, celebrating that. So congratulations. Hope you guys enjoy the holiday. The rest of us are ramping up, of course, for Christmas towards the end of the month and then New Year's. Very festive time going on right now. And what are we going to talk about today? We're going to talk about common mistakes, right? Like things that you want to watch out for that we, Swanley Mutunje and I, see happen very often during mentorship, right? So you're going to get a little bit of a buffet today of different ideas, right? Just different things. Some of them just happened this week, I would say, for me. I realized this happened in the past, but I think I gained the clarity as to like what was going on, what the fix is, and why they were doing what they were doing. So I'm really excited to share that. So let's say hello. Let's say hello to Swanley. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. Looking forward to this as always. Indeed, these are mistakes that I myself experienced these past couple of weeks on the Discord and in mentorship. So and it made me think, man, as you advance as an artist, it's easy to take things for granted, you know, and as a teacher, you really have to like stop and like go into every detail for the students. So hopefully this will be insightful.
Yeah, I think the idea of slowing down, you know, going as sort of granular as possible is important, you know. So, you know, your guys' job out in the audience today is, you know, help us, right? Help us help you. If you have questions, you know, type them into the chat. We're going to do our best to make all of the observations and answers as clear as possible. How are you doing, Mutunje?
Hey, guys. Yeah, great to be here again. And yeah, I am also looking forward to this because, you know, most of the mistakes that we are going to cover are the fundamental related ones, you know. So it's very easy to like just do these mistakes and, you know, people are like, oh, I can't understand what's happening. And the mistake isn't right in front of them, you know. So, yeah, excited to cover.
Sounds good. So before we get rolling onto everything, as usual, you know, if you enjoy what we're doing here, just remember that Mutunje, Swenley, and I all teach at drawingforce.com. That's where you can find us if you're interested in getting further drawing education with Force. If you enjoy the channel and what we're doing here, then please hit the subscribe button. And last but not least, you know, if you hit the notification bell, that will give you notifications, right? Instead of having to put this on your calendar or what have you and trying to remember it on your own. So with that, Mutunje, it's all yours whenever you're ready. Mutunje is going to head us up today.
Yes. Lead it. I'm going to share the screen. Yep. Can you see it?
Yes. It's coming on.
All right. Awesome. Yeah, let me know when you see it.
Yep. Now it's up.
All right. So, hello guys. The first, you know, we're just gonna cover like some different ones, right? Like common pitfalls, just like Mike said. You're gonna get a taste of like everything today, okay? So, I'm gonna cover some of the common pitfalls that, yeah, that's been repeated a lot of times, you know. So, with the mentorship, you know, me and Swenley, like we were also busy with the Discord. And yeah, there's like so much of, you know, these kind of mistakes, and those are the repeated mistakes, you know, again and again and again and again, which is, you know, we are happy to resolve. So one thing that I have always seen, now all of these mistakes that you can see, now I have groups here, the function, you know, like unbalanced figures, and then the angles. Now these are all just very, very related, especially the angles and, you know, the balance basically, okay? So first, let's go over the function, okay? Now, yeah, so I have like a few photographs here, you know, that I would like to talk about. And one of the common mistakes that I see students do a lot is when they're drawing the torso, you know, they're not drawing the full function, okay? So basically the first mistake that I'm gonna cover is not drawing the full function. Now, what does that mean, okay? So I'm gonna start with a very simple C torso here, Okay. So here is AC Torso. You know, many of you guys were on the website or a member or a mentee, they would know this. You know, it's very easy just to stretch and a squash on one of the ends. You know, people and students, they basically draw it like this. Okay. That's the first mistake. Okay. Let's see what's happening over here. As the one side stretches, the other side is getting squashed heavily. Okay. And you see, why is this getting squashed? You know, so a common understanding of force is, okay, force is starting up from here. It's going over here. And then voila, you know, it's ending up like from both the sides, it's ending up at the same place. So this is creating that compression, okay, right there. But when people draw it like this, it doesn't mean anything. You know? By the way, I used arrows over here. People don't draw arrows either, okay? So they just basically draw a line and then almost leave that part or just not draw it, you know, whatsoever. So basically what is happening, you're not drawing the full function whatsoever. I use a very good metaphor here, by the way. You know, I use a metaphor of a water, of like a water dam, okay? So imagine like this whole sea torso. This is like a water dam here, okay? I might have to do this with the blue color to give some flashier item. So let's say this is like the whole water here, okay? And imagine this, here's a gate, okay? So this is like the whole water dam system, and then here's a gate. And you see how the like water is going to rush here, that's the gate, okay? Like there's where all the pressure is going to release. And imagine it's not strong. See what happens, like the city, that part would be flooded, a town, city, whatever it is, that part would be flooded out, right? So all the water is just gonna spill out, you know, it's gonna create disaster. So basically, you can use the same metaphor here, and just remember that this part, this squash part, needs to be like super, super, super strong. Okay, so two ways you can do that. First of all, obviously draw it. You know, that's very straightforward. And then the second thing is you can use the line weight to press it down more, you know. So use line weight to show like more stronger of that part, okay? So yeah, water is not going to spill out now. And you're like drawing the whole function. So that's first thing. So let's go with this figure. That is why I'm keeping this figure with the C torso. You know, you can see how much compression that is happening, okay? You imagine like all the body weight like up there, even with the head, you know, that whole body weight is just pressing it down against this part over here. Okay, so you can understand the pressure over there. So basically, if you were to draw this one or any other torso, basically something like this, you can just create more pressure over there by using the line weight, and then try to draw the layers. Okay, you mean whenever you want to draw a squash, always think about the three parts, okay? The first is the rib cage. The second is the core section, which is our flexible part, the flexible, you know, the part of the torso. And then the third is the pelvis section, again, which is the hard part. So whenever you're drawing a torso, you're always looking for at least these three curves, okay? Or three layers, I should say. The first one, the second one, and the third one, okay? And sometimes people draw it like this. If you draw it like this, that would be like so much more relatable, okay, and much more correct as well. So yeah, try to see these three layers, okay, while you're drawing like a C torso. So that is what I call the mistake of not drawing I should say the full function of the figure. Okay, very, very common mistakes, very, very common pitfall. I see this mistake probably like 10, 20 times a week. Yeah, that is how common this is. Okay. All right. You can do it like this and then draw the center line. By the way, yeah, not to mention, maybe there are like some, I should keep like an honorable mention or something like that. Not drawing the center line is one of them, as well. Okay. So if you're not going to draw the center line, it's just going to be like a flat shape. If you draw the center line, it's also going to show like which side of it is. Maybe. So if I show the belly button with the center line, it's going to show that it's the front view. Or if I don't show this, then it could simply just be a back view as well. Okay. All right. Just maybe an honorable mention. All right. All right, is there any question on the chat?
No, you're all good.
Okay, good, good, good. So, second one, and I'm gonna cover the angles, okay? All right. So, drawing wrong angles, okay, very, very common mistake. And to start this off, I have this image over here, okay? This is a photograph taken in the middle of a motion, okay? So maybe the model is like starting to run or, doing some sort of motion, and then this picture was taken. So as you can see, this figure is unbalanced, right? Very a little uncomfortable to look at, I should say. Oh my God, oh, this leg has to be here, please make him ba make her balance, So yeah, to start off with the angles, I would just say if you're not making the right angles, the unbalanced nature of the pose will come out, okay? Or the pose will just fall, okay, not be balanced enough. And if you're being with us a little bit, for like little bit longer time, maybe you're a member or mentee, then you would know how important the angles are in terms of balance, okay? And the first function we always go for is the balance itself, okay? The first function we are going for that, oh, the figure should be the balance, okay? Figure should be balanced first. So yeah, I just showed this picture in the start of this conversation. We're gonna go to this image, let's say, and imagine what would happen if that arm, which is supporting the whole weight there, has a different angle. Okay, so let's try this out and see how this works. Do you see this whole body, right? Just look at this massive weight that this hand is bearing. Okay, something like this. I have to take another brush here. I'm gonna make it bigger. Okay, that's good. So anyway, you see like how much pressure there is, okay, on this one. And then you look at the hand. So I'm gonna draw the hand. I'm just gonna basically take this whole thing in here very, very quickly. Okay, so there's a leg coming out this towards us, and there's a leg going back here. Okay. Now see, the figure is balanced right now, but see if I just change the angle of this arm. Maybe something like this. Okay. You see what's happening? She's gonna end up on her face. Okay. That'll be painful. So this is a very, very straightforward example. But what I'm saying is, even if you change the angle like very, very slight, it's gonna create a lot of changes. Like there would be like a lot of changes to the way she's balancing. Okay. And yeah, I mean, you look at that and like a slight change could just make her fall on her face. Okay. Even if you do this, or let's say you do it right over here, and then she would need that hand to support herself. So she may be like using the other hand to like to support if that is the angle she's like aiming for in this hand over here. Okay. The slight change, especially in these kind of poses where it's crucial. Okay. Otherwise, the model can get hurt. Okay. So in this kind of, even in this kind of poses or any other kind of poses, the slight change of angle would create like a lot of changes into the like the person's balance, like the center of gravity, or the way they are trying to balance themselves. The angles, pretty important. Here's another example that you can have a look at. Okay. And then look at her. Now you see both the legs are parallel, by the way, right now, and both the legs are just trying to balance off, pretty crucially. But if we just change that a little bit, right? Let's try to create this. Gonna do a center line, and then imagine if I do that. So let's say I'm just like in a flow, and I'm very, very aggressively doing that, and all of a sudden I change the angle. I exaggerate the angle a little bit more. Now you see what's happened? This part of the model will become like super, super heavy. Again, you can use metaphors here. Imagine this is like a weighing scale, like the old traditional one, right? Something like this. And then you put like a lot of weight here. And oops. Yeah, this would be like very, very heavy over here. Okay. So, see what's happened. She's gonna fall right over there. I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna do that. Okay, and there's her face right over there. So, see what's happening? Okay, now she is really just falling onto the side. Okay, and again, she's gonna end up on her rear end. So there we go. She look, and just a slight change, you know, and it is just a very slight change. For example, if I want to correct this one, all I have to do is just change the angle with a very slight bit right over here. So the old angle, if I want to present the old angle would be like this, the one where she's in like unbalanced. Okay, you just see it's like this and this. We have covered this in the previous one. Like, if you want to like cause something, if you want to call something out, it's like, what is the exact angle here? You don't want to use maths here, but you can use like a metaphor of a clock. Okay. Mike used this a lot, and I started using this a lot as well. It's basically the hour end of the clock. Okay. So you can say, oh, it's like, this is what, 5:30, you know. And then this one is probably like 5. Okay. So you can see that that's just like a slight angle change there. Okay. And then finally, the angles leads us to, you know, drawing the figures like unbalanced, basically. Okay. So this is kind of like what I usually cover, but the both of those ones, you know, the angles and the figures being unbalanced, that is just very, very basically connected. Okay. Another thing is also losing the balance. You can also lose the dynamics of the pose, okay, which means you can make it less dynamic if you're like changing the angles. So for example, what is that thing that makes the figure dynamic, or what do we call like dynamic figure is basically the angles themselves. Okay, so for example, here's a standing figure, very, very small head. Oh no, I'm drawing on top of this. Wait a second, guys. Okay, I'm gonna draw it over here. Anyway, so what I'm just saying, let's say there be a person standing, okay, right over there. Person standing. So you see, like the observe the angles, okay, observe the angles of this person, right? Very straightforward. I mean, yeah, see, it's just standing. It's just a very, very straight line. Look at the angle of the limbs, very, very straight. It's very boring. Okay, I'm just going to change the angles of this a little bit. Maybe the angle of the shoulders, the angle of the hips, and you can come up with something like this. So you see what's happening? Okay, all of a sudden that I'm changing the angles of the whole body, and then all of a sudden this is like more dynamic than what we have before. Okay, so from this to this, basically. So angles play a crucial role, right? Crucial role in balance, and then crucial role in creating the dynamics of the body as well. Okay, so here you can see very like super contrasty, right? Super contrast in terms of angles, this pose, you know? And then again, you can observe the same thing, which is if I drew this, if I'm changing the angles of this, this could literally change the whole function of the pose. Now again, I'm connecting this to what I started with, which is the function. Okay. So imagine this is the torso angle, this is right. But I'm changing the angle of this to something like that. That's the hand. Okay. Something like that. Now see, it doesn't look as balanced, you know, whatsoever. And then let's say the angle of this becomes something like that. And then now this is becoming the lying leg. Okay, something like that. You see what's happening? Doesn't it just does change the whole pose. The whole pose is changed, which means the function of this is changed. And obviously the way he wants to balance himself, that changes as well. Okay. So what you might want to do, you might want to get this up and keep it over here, the same angle way. Okay. And now he just looks much more balanced. Okay. All right, so is there any question? Yeah, no. Okay. No question in chat, guys, right?
Nope.
Okay, great. Okay, you can have a look at this figure as well, right over here. You see now what he's doing. He's just feeling the energy. You know, maybe he's going into the open air, just like me, you know, after like hours, you know, on the end trying to work. And then he's feeling the breath of fresh air right there. So again, you can see like how crucial the angles is to his balance. Okay. And he's not going to like balance too much, you know, in there as well. Now there's one more thing, you know, what you can also observe with the balance that we all use in gravity guide. That is the first exercise, by the way, you know, just to let you guys know. And that is the center of gravity. Okay. Center of gravity is that concentration, you know, of the gravity. Okay. So wherever there is like the mass, that is going to be the most lovable to the gravity. Okay. That is the part which is trying to get to the ground, you know, as fast as possible, you know, more than the light parts. So in the males, that center of gravity rests up higher in the chest. Okay. Basically right in the upper section of the torso. So you can see like for him, like how he's balancing using the angles. He's basically doing this. Okay. You see like the foot is very, it's just creating, he's creating this triangle stance, you know, to like balance himself. So basically he's doing this. Okay. And then he's doing that. And imagine you disrupt the system. Okay. This whole thing, you know, what I'm teaching here is basically is a system, you know, to balance the models themselves. Okay. So, and you as a, you know, when you're doing the poses or if somebody else is doing the poses, your body knows like how to basically balance. Okay. When you lose that, basically we fall. Okay. So it's this whole system, and we know like how to balance, where to keep our feet, you know, in order to balance ourselves. So this whole system is going to disrupt if you are changing those angles. Okay. So remember that whenever you're drawing, you always are focusing on the angles in order to create the balance and in order to create the dynamics. Okay. And not to change the function of the whole figure in here as well. Okay. By the way, you can also see the squash is at the back right now. This is like a sea torso again. So you want to want to close that water dam gate. Okay. Right there. All righty. Alrighty, okay. So yeah, hope you I'm looking at the time. I think I'm out. Okay. Yep. All right. Hope you guys like this small segment. Okay. Just remember what you need to do. You need to draw the functions. Okay. You can take like a quick revision over here. You want to draw the whole function, okay, so you don't lose that feel and the functioning of the anatomy. Okay, this is how you can do it. You can use the heavy line weight in order to control it, okay, and then show that pressure. You can use that line weight to show the pressure of the force is like, oh, force is traveling from both the ends, okay, it's coming to the same spot, right? It's coming to the same spot in order to create the pressure over there, and you want to depict it in your drawings. Very, very common mistakes. Just like I said, I think in Discord, I'm sorry for that. I think in Discord and in the mentorship, right? The biggest mistake that I ever found, or the most common one. Then angles, okay? Again, very, very common. Okay, you want to draw the correct angles in order to understand the balance. Okay, so your figures don't become unbalanced, and then you're not changing the function of the figure as well. Okay, and yeah, not to mention, then you're also losing the dynamics of the figure. I'm gonna hand it over to Swendy. Swendy is going to cover some more common pitfalls for you guys. All
All right,
right.
thank you, Mitunjay.
Yeah, thank you guys.
Yeah, that was great. Hopefully that was
Excellent.
helpful. All right, so like Mike said, we have a buffet for you guys today. So I'm going to discuss some common mistakes that I see when students draw the neck and head. And it's pretty much like Mitunjay, these are things that I see a couple of times a week on Discord. So hopefully this will help bring some clarity. And it mostly has to do with structure, ironically. So the first one is, believe it or not, drawing the neck off center. Now, in a three-quarter view, I think it might not be that obvious, but I think since I come from industrial design, I'm very sensitive to structure. So if something is off, it just stands out for me and I cannot unsee it. So whenever I see something like this, I immediately picture in my mind what a figure would look like in a front view. And basically, this is what this drawing is suggesting, you know, that the neck is slightly off center. And I think if you come across someone whose neck is positioned like this, you probably would freak out. So please don't draw that. You want to make sure that the base of the neck, that ellipse, that we see right here, we want to make sure that the ellipse is properly built on the center line. So how do we deal with that? What I often do is, let's see, let's take this off. Where I start students often is actually starting with a triangle. Now, meaning you have the pit of the neck. Let's see, is this full opacity? Yeah, there we go. So we have the pit of the neck right there. And you can think of a triangle to start with because I think that's easier to position on the center. Now, so notice that the center line is defining the triangle in half, you know, so we have these two pizza slices basically. And I think if you start like this and think of this as being a volume, now of course this is round, this is a good start, you know, and then you can go back and you can make this a bit rounder. Now, because at the end of the day, the base of our neck is not a perfect ellipse. And the proof of that is when you wear a shirt. Now, if you think of the collar of a shirt, now if you look at the shape that it creates, it shows you that shows you the like the shape of the base of the neck. Now, it's essentially around a triangle, which makes sense because you have the pit of the neck at the front, so it's a bit narrower here, you know, and then it widens. We have the neck muscles and such. So this is the shape. So that's why I usually start with a triangle. Even when drawing from imagination, I often start with a simple triangle. Now and make sure that it's centered. And then I can go back and, you know, make this slightly rounder. That gives you a properly centered neck. So whenever you draw that neck, make sure that the base is properly built on the center line so you don't get odd placements for the neck. So that is number one. And the second challenge that I see students face with a head and neck is actually how to properly connect the neck to the head. Now, and I've seen this many, many times. You know, students would come in with a pretty good basic structure for the head. You know, perspective is good. The base of the neck is there. You know, it might even be well centered. But then once we get here, like what's happening? Like how does this volume of the neck, this cylinder, how does it connect to the head? Now, here there's no connection. You know, this is going flat right here. So how do we solve this problem? How do we connect this properly? Well, let's look at an actual head. So we have a profile right here. And structure is basically looking at an object and being able to break it down into its smaller parts. So in this case, we have three main components. We have the neck, We have the cranium and we have the face and the jaw. So if we draw that in a little diagram right here, now really simple in a side view. So we have the neck. Of course, it's an angle, so it is the pit of the neck. And in this position, we would have like a strong curve at the front. Now the back would be a bit straighter. So we have the neck, and right here, this is where the neck connects to the cranium. Now notice that this also approximately lines up with the base of the ear and the base of the nose. And this, there's a slight bit of perspective in here, so now this would be like slightly round. But notice that this lines up. And if you look at a skull, you will see that you have the base of the cranium right here. So we have the neck volume. Actually, let me draw it here. I think it will be clear. Now, so there we have the base of the neck. And here's where the neck connects to the cranium. Now I can see a little bit of the neck muscle here. Now, so this would go over to the other side if we think through. Now, so you can use the neck muscle to basically create like a front plane for the neck. Now we have this plane for the neck form. So this is number one. Then we have the cranium, which is kind of like an egg form. I also have the cranium sitting on top. That's number two. And then we have the jaw. And that's number three. And the jaw also connects here. No, and then on top of that, you can build this smaller forms. Like you have the spleen at the bottom of the chin. Now you have like a smaller cylinder sitting on the front of the neck, but those are secondary. Now, like this is important. These are the basic forms. And as you can see, if we think of the side plane, now notice that this is pretty big, this plane right here. This is all the side plane of the neck. So once we get to the three-quarter view, we need to at least see a little bit of this plane right here. It's not going to disappear all of a sudden. So if we take this away and we go to a new layer. So I'm going to start with those neck muscles here and go to the pit of the neck. Now, if we think through like this, this starts on the other side as well, creating that triangle. Now we have the pit of the neck right here. And we have the base of the neck. And this is important because, again, we have this connection here. So we need to make sure that we connect the head to the back of the cranium right there. Now, this actually one. It's actually one unit. Now, so the neck continues and flows seamlessly into the back of the cranium there. Now, so this importance, making sure that you have the side plane. Now, and this would be the front plane. And now, because this is round, we would still see like a little bit of the farther side right here. Now, that gives us proper volume. So this is the base. Now we go up and we connect it to the base of the cranium. Again, this lines up with the bottom of the nose approximately. So this is how you solve the problem. Now think of the three basic components. You have the neck volume. You have the cranium sitting on top of that, and then you have the jaw. Now, and this is your starting point. Any questions, by the way, Mike?
No, you're all good.
Okay. Everyone is quiet and studying, hopefully. So
Yeah,
that's a good
I'm
sign.
fielding most of them. There were some
Okay.
questions about the head and if it was the same, for different figures, and obviously all the connections, the anatomy is the same, but a lot of different proportions you might run into,
Yeah, so you just basically take the basic structure and you adapt it to the individual that you're drawing. No, but it's good to have, you need a general like structure in mind that you can adapt. Otherwise, you're starting from zero, which makes it so much harder. Okay, so the last one is distorted perspective. And man, this is so common. And that is why it's so important to learn perspective and especially to learn to draw a freehand box, a proper freehand box in perspective and making sure that it's undistorted, meaning that everything converges to the vanishing points properly. Because once you get to the head, if you can't draw the box properly, it's not going to happen here. No, the mistakes are going to transfer to everything that you built. So what's the problem here? Well, we have distorted perspective angles. One of the rules of perspective is that parallel lines converge to the same vanishing point. So if you have a cube or a plane, let's say there's a front view, and these are the parallel lines. And if we take this and if we place it in perspective, now these parallel edges are going to converge towards a vanishing point. So if they continue, eventually they're going to meet at what we call a vanishing point. So what you don't want to do is reverse this, meaning that as those edges recede in 3D space, they get wider apart instead of closer together. So they need to go and meet at a vanishing point. So if they get wider apart, they're never going to meet. So you're basically breaking perspective. And that is essentially what's happening here. So notice that if we extend these lines, notice that these edges, especially the chin, like these guys are never going to meet. Now, the further we extend them, the farther apart they get. So this gives us distortion. Now it looks like the face is bending in all kind of weird ways. And a great way to check perspective, by the way, is rotating the page, giving yourself a fresh view. Now, from some angles, it's going to be, I think, much obvious than others. Like if you look at it from this angle, I can clearly see that, hey, these guys are distorted. They're never going to meet at a vanishing point. So the solution to that is, of course, making sure that at the very least they need to be parallel. Now, if you can like pinch those angles slightly, it's even better. So let's say that we start with the eye line, and let's say this is the correct perspective angle. So then for the chin, we need to make sure that this guy is going to meet the eye line. No, so it's very close to parallel. Again, we could pinch it a little bit more if you want to be sure. So we could say we're going to pinch it just slightly like that. And we have to do that for the guideline for the nose as well and for the mouth. So all these guys need to be parallel or they have to at least converge a little bit. And let's see, this one looks pretty good already. Maybe just a slight change. And again, we can rotate the page to check. So this looks pretty good. Like all these guys are following the perspective rule. So this guy would be good to go. And the other common error that I see with the heads. Now, this is another kind of distortion. So What's the problem here? Well, the problem is the relationship between the front plane and the side plane, and in particular the angle. Now, like once we take that corner, this angle is starting to go up too fast, and same for the top plane. So if we think of this heads in a side view, and let's say there's the face. Now, so the face is going to be our vertical. And if the perspective is correct, now the head is going to be like the top of the head, for example, is going to be perpendicular to the face, you know, in a very simple manner. So this should be more like a rectangle. Now, so this would be the eye line. Now, so that's the halfway point, and this is the top of the head. But what we have here is suggesting that the eye line is all of a sudden at this angle, and the top of the head is of this angle. So if we had a profile, this head would be severely distorted. Also, the head would look something like this. And this is the problem because this angle is off. It needs to be like perpendicular to the front of the face. So in order to fix this, now it takes again some practice with drawing the cube properly in perspective. Now, with practice, you will learn to see the correct angle. Now, like I can see this relationship. Now, like it has to be like this. And same for the top plane of the head. Also, we need to tilt that plane down a little bit. Now the front is all already correct, so that one is good to go. So this gives us the proper structure. So notice that now the side plane is perpendicular to the front plane. You know, so there's a 90 degrees relationship between the two. And this sets you up with a proper basic structure for the head. So yeah, those are my insights for today. Hopefully that was helpful. I'm going to give it over to Mike. You ready, Mike?
I'm ready.
Okay, good.
Okay, I'm not ready. I'm not ready. Hold on a second. Sorry, I'm just cracking myself up. Right, everyone. I have three things I want to share with you today that have come up in just the last couple of weeks and also repeat themselves quite often. The first one is what I've been labeling the snowman. Right. So what does that mean? Right. What does a snowman have to do with figure drawing? Quite a bit, actually. It's a poor guy. One thing you don't want to do is be a snowman and have deal with rain or sleet, that's for sure. So what does that have to do with figure drawing, right? So I had a student, a mentee, this week come in with this drawing, and I created these ellipses here, right? So she's still relatively new to the process, you know, of drawing with force. And I you know, at the beginning, I don't mind sort of testing the waters, sorry, my East Coast is slipping. Testing the waters here with staying on the rails of force or leaving a little bit, giving the student some room to feel their way around, right? And then, you know, and obviously then the challenge is, of course, making sure I call out when there's an issue, right? So this is an issue. This is a very big issue. So, you know, I called her out on this. I was like, watch out for this. This is why I don't do things in a certain way. And the thing I do not do is we don't add too much form to the figure when we're starting off, right? And I know there's a ton of instruction out there that's telling you the opposite. And it's like, hey, here's the rib cage, right? So in this case, this is why you see these numbers on my drawing here, or the student's drawing, I should say, but This, you know, it's the rib cage, right? And then here's sort of the core, right? And then here's the pelvis, right? The challenge would sees that, it recognizes that, and wants to stick to that, right? And that's why I prefer the abstraction of force. It sure it has its downfalls as well. It's like you know, we had a question earlier about like proportion and so on. It's hard to manage those things, but we're all okay with that. It's okay that there's a little bit of slip and slide going on at the beginning with those forces and the proportions. I'd rather have that than have this happen, which leads us to the snowman. And the snowman, the whole metaphor here is we have these three chunks, right? These three sections, section one, section two, and section three. And the last thing we want to do is segment out parts of the body, right? You don't want to segment out the body. We want to understand, in this case, for today, we want to understand the torso, right? So we want this to become one thing, the torso. Sure, the torso is made of the rib cage, the core, and the pelvis, but combined, they make one thing. And I want you to understand the one thing before you start understanding the three things, right? That's how we teach hierarchically, right? So it's the big idea versus the smaller ones. So what we want to do here instead is say, you know, what's going on with this model? Well, this model's stretching, right? Get those verbs in there. This model's stretching along the front of her body. You know, that's sweeping up off, or, you know, off of this shoulder. You can see the shoulder is pulling up like that, right? That's part of the stretching that's going on here. And then coming down the rib cage down to the back, right? That way. And then sweeping down and around the bottom of the pelvis to the rear end. And then this is also pushing up over here, right? So that's what we're looking for. This is a much better shape. You know, Mrtunjay talked about this earlier. You know, you can close this off with like the lumbar region right here. And now suddenly we have this much bigger shape. It actually feels forceful, right? It has clear direction in it. Does it help to know those three things are in there? Sure. I can't say it doesn't, but it could hurt if what you're doing is saying, hey, I'm going to draw the rib cage, I'm going to draw the core, and I'm going to draw the pelvis, right? And then you start drawing the body, and it's like this, right? And so on. Now, actually, I think what I recall is this particular pose was actually an S torso. So how do you fix this, right? Well, you don't want that and that and that. What you want here would have been the curve of the back, and this would have straightened out, right? The front of the rib cage would straighten out, and we want to pull across the core. So I am going from the bottom of the ribs, I'm pulling across the core to the top of the pelvis here, like so. So now that's the rhythm. Right. And now I have more of a straight edge against the curve. What you're trying to stay away from and why this sort of egg-like shape doesn't work in the torso is because it's a bad shape, right? You're pushing force out both sides. It can't fluidly move through this shape design. This is more of the shape design that we want. Looks like this. Right. And that's pulling me down into the stomach and into the pelvis, right? Here's like the abdomen. And then I could sweep around and come up and still have my straight in there, right? And all of a sudden, that leads me to a much better shape design, right? So now I have an S torso. I did a C for you, and here's an S. Either one of them breaks the snowman, right? No snowmen, no snow women, no snow people in your drawings, right? So don't bring in that three-tiered stacked structure of ellipses. You do that, and you're already dead in the water. It's game over. It's just not going to work. And then you have to back your way out. That's right. As Dyson said, it's like the blasphemous egg. It's the blasphemous rib cage and blasphemous core and blasphemous pelvis, right? So I want to be very, very careful about that. Bad, bad shape design. Okay. So that's my first one, right? Be aware of the snowman. No snowman. The second one. Yes. So the second one is perspective. A couple of quick tips about perspective that I see happen. So when we teach perspective to students in mentorship, we teach them this four-point perspective grid, right? So you've got your horizon or horizontal, you got your vertical, you got your vanishing points, right? And then we teach them how to do extension lines, right? That come from these points, right? So you end up with this four-point grid. I really like the four-point grid. It's easy for me to wrap my head around and understand how it represents the human eye, right? You can see how things pinch at the corners and then they they open up, the angles open up at the center, right? So it's like this, here's your eyeball basically, right? So I get that, it's teachable. I really understand it. I'm able to get students to understand it, right? And it works. But sometimes there's a couple of things that happen here that kind of go astray. So let me grab this here from the thumbnail. We'll bring this guy forward. So this is from a mentorship session, right? Again, let's close that. So a couple of things happened here. The one I want to point out is one rule that you have to stick to with the grid is every line of the box has to go to a point, right? Every line. That's what the point of the grid is, right? You can't break the grid, right? The grid is master. So you can see here, this student drew this box on a diagonal, right? And some of the lines start to match up with the points and some don't, right? So the vertical is really thrown off here, right? The vertical is right here, these vertical lines. And that really throws everything off. So that kind of reminded me of Inception, right? Of Inception, and that's what you're doing. You're like creating a topsy-turvy world by allowing that stuff to skew all over the place like that, right? So you can't do that, right? I can't say in here, you know, hey, I have a box, right? I have the beginnings of a box I'm drawing here and I'm following the extension. And then you look at that and go, oh, I see. Yeah, that box would look good like this. And then not. All of a sudden it's like that. They come in with the homework and I'm like, all right, that's cool. It looks like a good box, right? Which it does. But I would say, well, where are these lines going, right? Like that vanishing point that's supposed to control that, that's all the way over here, right? So suddenly you're making up your own rules, right? And we don't want to do that, especially when we're learning the grid, right? Like that's the homework. So that's number one, right? You really got to follow those points and make sure everything works. Now, another thing that happens pretty commonly with the grid that I see come in from students is they draw too close to the edges. It's like, stay away from the edge of the cliff over here, right? That's like far extremes of your peripheral. Students get themselves out there into these peripheral areas and they end up inverting how the grid works. They'll end up drawing a box that looks something like this. So the box looks good, right? Again, it's a pretty good looking box. It's just that that box does not belong in that space, in that location, in this grid. That box, believe it or not, actually belongs like somewhere up here, all right? Because this would be its verticals then, and it would rotate and come up here. Why does it not work here? Well, because what's happened in a sense, this is going to be really weird, so bear with me. We're going to do a little Inception here. They've made these two points. This is a horizontal point. That's a vertical point. They've made those two points both become horizontal points. So we're really looking at this box like this, right? There's my two horizontals. That's affecting those planes of the box. But where's the vertical going? Sometimes they'll go to that center point, which I don't teach that. That's like a 5-point grid. I don't usually go to that. Or they're just going to no man's land. They're like going out here somewhere. And I'm like, where's the point, right? So you got to be really mindful of that, right? Like this box here would not look like that, right? If I did it correctly, let's grab white and kind of just knock it back and try to draw on top of it. If I were to draw a box there correctly, right, then this is okay because that's going to the point to the left. This is okay, but this side, the right side of the box, that needs to go all the way out there. So it's actually like this, right? And the back view here is really important, getting that back edge. Notice the left side goes to the right back, and then this guy will determine this bottom corner. So here's the box, here's the bottom of it. That's what the box looks like in this location in the grid, right? So there's the answer to that one. So be aware when you're practicing 4-point perspective grids, don't get too close to the edges. It always ends up confusing everyone. Don't make gigantic boxes. You don't normally see that in life anyway. Sure, if you're in New York, you know, and you're by some skyscraper, you could end up with this kind of situation, right? You'd have to like look up and look down. You'll actually see the bend in space, right, past the horizontal or horizon, and you will get stuff like this. But just watch the edges, because as soon as people get there, like I said, they end up creating their own vanishing points. Things get skewed, and they misdelegate like the jobs of the points and what they're supposed to do actually to that particular box in that location. Every location on the grid, the box is predetermined as to what it's going to look like, because the grid is already telling you what that box is going to look like, and you can't break that. Once you get to this understanding, sure, then you can go and draw freehand boxes, right? And understand how to control that space. And hopefully the learning of the grid is what helps you draw the freehand boxes, right? Let's see. So B1 says, do you recommend not trying to rotate the box while learning this? Yes, that's exactly right. I would start here. And then if you'll notice in the students' work, this is something I just recently started doing more often, is then I'll have students draw the box more in a linear fashion. So either in a column or a row across the grid, and try to keep the volume relatively the same, so you can actually see how the vanishing points help the box turn or lift it up and down. But you're seeing different angles of it, right? And then after that, we go into the freehand box, which you see the student was trying to do up here, right? Okay, last but not least. Last but not least. So before I came in today, I typed in two tubes and I got this. So I thought I would scare you guys as much as it scared me. Which is a character from the Star Wars universe. So that was kind of interesting. It was not what I was expecting at all. What I was looking at for was something like this, right? Like a bunch of toilet roll paper roll tubes, right? So why am I bringing this up? Well, I'm going to bring in another student's work, and that is this, right? So here's the model. All right, here's the model. Great job the student did here of writing. I love that. Lunging legs, upward po upright posture, right? Awesome job that she's doing that. This is from another mentorship meeting just this week alone, right? So hopefully this is also giving you a little insight of what happens in mentorship. It's like I'm calling things out here. You know, all three of us, Swami and I, we're doing draw overs, right? It's like this is how we teach, right? Tubes, super important, right? What's important about the tube, to kind of give it an abstract clarity, is direction, right? Direction in space. You can think of it as either, you know, is this tube here, let's call this tube A, is this tube going into the page or coming out of the page? It's all relative. Doesn't matter to me. Just make sure that it's in that axis, right? And it's structured right in space, right? Very important. So not only is the angle of it important, getting across the long axis is important, and the short axis is important, right? So, you know, this is again the long axis is the short axis, right? Like being aware that these things are right and they match up with the angle of the object, right? So you can see here, I redrew this leg for the student. They actually had the ellipses inverted, right? So you could see here, I'm saying this leg is going away, right? It's going away from me. So here's the tube. I had one student some months back was having a little bit of a tricky time understanding how to do this on the figure. And something clicked for him where he was like, oh, it's like a Coke can. Right. So you could pick your favorite beverage, right? He happened to pick Coke, but sure, you want to think of it as a Coke can, think of it as a Coke can, right? Either way, what you want to be aware of is one end of the tube you can look into, and the other one you cannot, right? I can look into this end of the tube, but I can't look into this end because of that arc, right? It's blocked from my view. So in this particular case, with this drawing, I can look in to this side. Right, this end of the leg. I can't down the other side because it's blocked, right? So I'm looking into the tube that way. Look at this leg, right? You'll notice this leg is also incorrect, right? The axis is correct. That red line is pretty good, but we need to look down into this leg from the top down to the bottom and look at the ellipses. Notice the long axis, they're on diagonals. It's a little better up here, right? So I'm going from the tips of the ellipse. Notice here they're angled, here it's angled. That shouldn't happen, right? They should basically ladder each other, right? They should be parallel to each other through that form. So that's another thing, but we want to be aware of that, right? So instead, here's our like mentorship session, right, with the group. Let me just block this out a little further, right? There. So I want that axis in there. I want my 90 degrees. It's very tricky to get this 90 in here, I have to say. When you have a strong angle on something, you know, it's like you want to skew it. It's actually two-dimensional in a sense. You really just want this like 90 degrees. And then you really want to get the ellipse to go from here to here on its long axis, right? It's something like that. I could even flatten this out a little bit more like that, right? And you want to get from there to there, right? So now what happens is just how round is it? So, you know, if I do that, that's a very narrow ellipse. I think it's a little more than that, right? I think I want to open up a little bit more and really make believe I'm wrapping around the leg. I don't want to really wrap around it, feel the mass of it. Usually, you know, you can't see the photo that much here anymore, but when you're on the photo, you really start to get a sense of what looks right, you know? So there's the ellipses. So it should look something like this. So we're looking into the top of the can, right? We're going into the Coke can that way, right? And the bottom we can't see because it's facing downward, you know, down here, right? So that's it, right? That's my segment. Those are the three big pieces. It's the snowman, the perspective grid, and last but not least, these tubes, right? Super important. You want to make sure they're force tubes, of course, but you want to make sure they're right in the right angles, okay? So in closing, again, if you like what we're teaching, please visit us at drawingforce.com. That's where the three of us live. It's a condo. We each have our own bedroom, right? And if you like the channel here, please subscribe. Please share the information with, you know, your fellow friends and artists. Let's build up a community here as much as we can. And thank you, Swenley and Mutunjay, for all your hard work today. And we will all see you next Friday.
Sure. See you bye, guys.
Take care.
See you, everyone. Have a great weekend. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.